Good afternoon, everyone. We are going to another session of ECO today. Topic will be on wound management. Sorry for the questions. So, the agenda for today will be initial few minutes. We will spend some time on looking on your experiences in the past. Like, you might have presented few cases here. So, depending on the suggestions, if they help you or you could do something which is very different from what you were doing. And the next, followed by a presentation on wound management by Rani, followed by a case presentation and discussion. So we start, we spend a few minutes on discussing previous week, taking wound management or something that we could have. If the discussions helped you in any manner in your practice or managing the case you present. Is there anyone?
Sister Valsala.
मैं सिस्टर को बहुत बोली थी मैंने जा मैं
Everyone, please unmute yourself while you are not speaking because it's causing a lot of interference in voice. Please unmute. Please mute yourself when you are not speaking. Please. Sister Valsa, would you like to share some experience that you got from this discussion?
Hello.
Would you like to say something about your case presentation? How physician taking your was there something beneficial? Mr. Valsa, are we audible? Can you hear?
Ma'am, I am not presented yet. So I cannot tell you regarding the case present. Which of case present?
Okay. Anyone else who has presented the case? Yes.
Yeah. I have heard a case about two children who are discussed now with leukodystrophy, and. So we had discussed whether they were not able to communicate to us, and then we assumed that they were coming. And previous week their mother brought him with a bed sore, and because of a severe contracture of the hand, child got wounds in his hands. So we started morphine. I started morphine IMGTDS for him. And after half an hour, I could see that he was getting relaxed. And then we could all his fingers, the handkerchief side, and do his dressing. And afterwards, he is on MG, morphine, GDS, and he is faring rather well. His mother used to say that whenever this child used to cry out of pain, she used to say, my soul is going away from that, I feel like that, used to say. And see that pain, and easily we could see that child with the cry. He was having maybe, the score must have been 10 out of 10. And so I did not go for a muscle relaxant. The sir had told me to try with a sitamol muscle relaxant. And tablet baclofen costs 15 rupees per tablet. So they couldn't afford also with that. Anyway, I'm happy that I attended this course, and because of that, I was able to manage that case properly. And there was one more case which I have not discussed. It is a cancer patient who had come to me, and without revealing the diagnosis, and because of the what we had, I could take them easily and counsel properly and give them palliative care. These are two experiences which I wanted to share.
The improvement for that child. Thank you.
So we would encourage everyone to write a paragraph about how it helped in your patient. So we will move on to the presentation for today. We will be learning about wound management, and Sister Anu is with us, and she is a very experienced nurse in the field of palliative nursing. And she is currently the nurse coordinator working in Pondicherry with Mahatma Gandhi Medical College. And we are running a very successful palliative care unit there. Welcome, Anu. Anu. I'll be sharing the screen from here, Anu. You can save whenever you want to change the slide.
Next. So today we will be dealing more about wound management in palliative care. So two topics that I have selected is, one is bed sore care, and the other one is fungating wound management or general wound management. So first we will take fungating or general wound management, and then we will tell in detail like what are the specific nursing measures for fungating malignant wound management. So as an introduction, fungating malignant wound is a distressing problem for a significant number of patients with advanced cancer. These wounds are very common in squamous cell carcinoma, osteosarcomas, and lot many other carcinomas where nodules are formed and which really breaks up and forms into a wound. Fungating wounds rarely heal. So this is one question like patients and bystanders always ask, when it is going to heal, what time it will take, and things like that. So it rarely heals actually. Goal is to maintain or improve quality of life through proper symptom control. So our measure is, we will be like slowly in the patient, and we'll be taking all the symptom parts, but then again they require a lot of counseling and reassurance. So if it is not healing, then we need to live the rest of the life with this particular. The term fungating refers to a malignant process of both ulcerating and proliferative growth. Fungating lesions are product of cancerous infiltration of the epithelium, which develop into a fungating mass or an ulceration with subsequent infection, sometimes bleeding and malodorous exudate. So if the fungating, sometimes the lesion presents with a mixed appearance of both proliferative and ulcerative areas. So the thing is that either if it is a bulging kind of like a cauliflower kind of thing, which is a fungating mass, or a creator type ulceration, anything can happen, and sometimes mixed types also we have seen in breast cancers and all. So we should be able to like classify which type is our the wound. A fungating wound may develop in the following ways: as a result of primary skin tumor, through direct invasion of the structures of the skin by a tumor. From metastasis spread of a distant tumor, malignant changes may develop in chronic wounds like Marjolin's ulcer, where you know chronic wound changes into squamous cell carcinomas, which again ends up in either ulcerative wounds or a proliferative wounds.
Breaking in between.
Can I try to use
Yeah, got back, but it is not coming on this one. So go to this one now. I don't know whether my attendance will come or not.
Am I audible now?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, now it is better. Can you just try?
I'll continue with this then. So now coming to pathophysiology. So all of you have clearly understood what are the types of fungating wound type. So now coming to pathophysiology. So it may be result of a primary tumor through direct invasion of structures by either skin by an underlying tumor from metastatic spread of a distant tumor. This is very common in ovaries, and or sometimes it really comes out as a malignant ulcerative wounds in the abdomen also. Rarely malignant changes may develop in chronic wounds, which ends up in Marjolin's ulcer. Next slide. So it start as discrete non-tender nodules. So nodules always, whenever we suspect anything, the first thing that we may need to check for is a nodule. Can be of skin tone, pink, red, violet, blue, black or brown, depending upon the type of underlying issue. As malignant cells grow and divide, the nodule enlarge, interfere with skin capillaries and lymph vessels. Lesions that have predominantly proliferative growth may develop into a nodular fungus or a cauliflower-shaped lesion, whereas a lesion that is ulcerating will produce a wound with crater-like appearance. So in the first two images, you can see like cauliflower growth kind of wounds, and the other last third image, a crater-like appearance. So when it comes to wound, maybe because of lack of our time and all, we may be focusing our care more on the wound part or wound management part, maximum extending to the pain part. But a patient who is living with the fungating wound, he or she has lot of issues like physical, psychological, social and spiritual, which really wanted to like, which is really something very important for the patient, because even today we had a filariasis patient. He was in the merge of committing a suicide because of, you know, living with filariasis, big leg for past 10 years. Now it got infected, pus is coming, maggots infestation. So on a daily basis, he or she has lots of problems. So as a palliative care healthcare provider, we really need to look into all these aspects, pain, malodor, X-ray, yes, everything is there. But other than that, psychological issues, social issues, isolation, spiritual issues, everything. Next slide, please. This is one of our patients who got admitted last year. So you can see the difference between the personality, how he was previously, what happened when he got a fungating wound in his cheek, which really affected his quality of life. So when he came to us with this particular wound with maggots, you can even see two maggots in the picture. This is after cleaning him. But then his main question was, his main request was, he really wished to see his daughter's marriage, and he really don't know even to tell, like, whether it is right to tell that he really want to see daughter's marriage directly with his own eyes. but then he somehow opened up. And the other part is, you may think that he is in severe pain, he may require morphine. His pain was completely managed by just tramadol alone and paracetamol along with that. Other than that, his priority, top priority was somehow to live till his daughter's marriage, and he want to be in the same auditorium near to daughter when his daughter getting married. You can imagine the amount of smell that he has, or the amount, the issue with the oozing wound or everything. Somehow we managed completely, removed all the maggots, packed nicely. He stayed with us, maintained his nutrition and hydration, and he lived for 4 months with this wound, completed his all the preparation for his daughter's marriage. After marriage, even for another 2 weeks, he lived, and then he died. We were planning for feeding gastrostomy to prolong his, because that was his main request. But somehow with an NG tube alone, nutrition was maintained. Nutrition and hydration was maintained. Slide. So physical problems, pain, malodor, infection, bleeding, communication difficulties, exudates, infection, infestation with maggots, size, shape of the wound, and comfort of dressing. These physical problems are directly an issue with the psychological problem, because if the wound is in an area where the slide is moved. Excuse me, I cannot see the slide. I cannot see the slide.
Can everyone else
see? Yeah, now I can see. So the main problem with the wound is mainly two things in our experience. One is where the wound is. If it is in an area where it really affects our personal roles and relationship in society, like face or hands, where it is like it can be seen from outside, then the quality of life is very, very much affected badly. If it is on the face, if it is on the hands, if it is on the legs. And the other part is, if this wound is affecting movement and mobility, then again the patients have lot of tailor-made issues. Like they have their own lot of unique issues which really need to be addressed properly. And the third problem, usually if the wound is in skin folds, creases and all, then again they have lot of issues. So mainly we need to see the problems of patients who have wounds on their face. Whether it is same fungating wound, it will be different for a patient who has a wound on his chest or breast. So everything have got its own meaning for the patient. So we really need to understand what type of issues the patient has. Sometimes top priority may be altered body image, sexuality, especially with females, denial, embarrassment, fear, depression and anxiety, shame, guilt, lack of self-respect, self-esteem. Everything is a problem. Slide. So psychological issues, we really have to spend time with them and understand their problem. Most of the time it requires family counseling, family therapy, reassurance, lot of time involved therapies to really improve their quality of life. Now coming to social part, family isolation, social stigma, fear of spreading contagion, effects on the family, effects on sexual relationship and marital disharmony. Coming to spiritual, indifference with religious rites, especially for Muslims, they could not do the namaz properly. Punishment from God, fear of impending death. This wound is a constant reminder of something like an advanced progressive illness. So they always have something like deep in their mind, I'm going to die. Like what kind of life it is. So everything we really need to sit with the patient and understand. Not just dressing alone will help these kind of patients. Next slide. Palliation of symptoms. So first principle is we really need to palliate all the symptoms. Symptoms of physical, psychological, social and spiritual. So a symptom per se, controlling infection, odor, managing exudate, protecting the surrounding skin, minimizing bleeding and reducing pain. Holistic care, empowering patient and family in wound care. So we really should have a proper wound assessment regarding whether it is infected or not, malodor is present or not, exudate, is it highly exudate or like minimal exudate, the surrounding skin, what is the color of the surrounding skin, whether it peeling is there, any other nodules are there, whether it is dry, excoriation, everything we need to try. Minimize bleeding, where the location of the wound is it near any major blood vessel, is there a chance to have a sudden bout of sudden episode of bleeding. So everything we should anticipate and then start giving care. And pain again, pain is chronic pain once again, whether it has a neuropathic element of it, and dressing, procedure related pain, movement related pain, everything we should have a consideration of it. So everything we have to plan and then have a proper care plan for our patient. Slide. So assessment, impact of disease. So impact of disease, I have put it as process and burden and treatments. So everything, not only this wound has got an impact on the patient's life, but the underlying disease process, whatever cancer or lymphedema or gangrene or whatever it is, a stem which is unhealing or whatever, the process has got an impact of the process have got an impact on the patient, and the treatment part also has got an impact on the patient. Comorbidities, something like diabetes wound, peripheral vascular disease, coagulation therapy, clotting problems, impairment, hearing loss, blindness, everything we need to assess properly. Allergies, whether sensitivities to dressing products or dressing tape. Nutrition, very important, especially for head and neck cancer. They may not have always a brain mets, or we can evaluate it. Again, if properly nutrition and hydration is maintained there, the survival, I am not telling it as survival, but you know, their lifespan will be much more than we are expecting, even with a bigger wound. So the possibilities of providing proper nutrition should be clinically evaluated, and we should take a clinical decision upon it. Wound location, public view, impairment in mobility, wound appearance, ulcerating, bleeding, necrotic tissue, or fistula formation is there or not, exudates, etc. Surrounding skin, if it is radiation related skin damage, then we should provide proper meticulous skin care. If it is erythematous, then need to know what is the reason for it and then act accordingly. Symptoms like pain, pruritus and malodor, potential for serious complications like compression, hemorrhage and obstruction. So everything we need to check. Criteria for wound dressing. Yes, it is usually nurses who are going for dressing. We really, now we got an overview of like bird's eye view or like in detail view of what all things can happen to these kind of patients. So it should be kind of little empathetic care. By means of little, what I mean to say is like you have to be proactive, you have to be empathetic, you have to be assertive also in nature a lot of many times, and empathetic care you have to ensure. Provide a thorough bath before dressing. This is very important. Otherwise, most of these patients have really very bad smell, which even in sometimes like home care and all, we may not be able to do our dressing for 30 minutes. So always give them a very thorough bath from head to toe. Even if possible, apply emollients or shampoo or moisturizing cream, so that the oozing, the smell, which will not really affect you in providing dressing, because patient is always watching your face too while doing dressing. So make sure that you are also very comfortable. Ensure that the patient had a dose of analgesic before dressing, and this bath really helps in keeping the patient also comfortable for some time. Use a normal saline for cleaning the wound. Select dressing depending upon whether it is highly exudative or a minimal or dry wound or just normal wound or fungating wound. with maggots. So you have to select the dressing materials. Attention to wound margin and healthy tissues. This is for wound debridement. Next. Minimizing pain. Hope you all had a discussion on pain management in that procedural pain management. So drugs. We really use a lot of drugs. Orally, systemic use of drugs, and also like local application of lignocaine and dressing, non-stick dressing, soaking and dressing off slowly. When you remove the dressing, soak it off and then slowly remove it off. Always have polythene covers or whatever to discard this used dressing, because again that itself will be another source of smell. Use a local anesthetic gel like lignocaine. Using painkillers, apply directly to the wound or a gel topical opioids. Sometimes we use that. Additional dose of an analgesic before wound dressing. So if the patient is on morphine, you can even give an extra dose of morphine before dressing if required. Otherwise, oral ketamine, sublingual ketamine, anything can be used for managing procedural pain. Next. Malodor. Malodor is something like the family and patients are very much in distress of. So what we really use here is metronidazole. The tablet metronidazole, uncoated, we crush it and powder it and we keep it ready. So if it is a painful wound, apply metrogel and xylocaine jelly together as a paste. Sometimes, like deep wounds, we use IV metronidazole for irrigation, and we start systemic antibiotics, frequent changing of dressing. We don't use usol or hydrogen peroxide or betadine or whatever be other than that for chronic wound management in our institution. So bleeding. So first of all, in the beginning of the slide, I have told you, for bleeding, we really need to know where the wound is. Is it near a major blood vessel? So what are the other potential chances of bleeding in future? So all these things we have kept in mind. We have to keep in mind before dressing. And now if there is bleeding, apply local pressure, sucralfate powder, adrenaline packs, systemic ethambutolate, tranexamic acid, surgical procedures, palliative radiotherapy. Palliative radiotherapy is like very useful for some osteosarcoma related wounds, which really shrinks the wound, prevents stops bleeding, and the mass of the wound will be reduced. So you can consider anything, and sometimes even some chemotherapy, palliative chemotherapy also helps. But this will be like only with the clinical consultation with an oncologist, you plan on all these things. Now coming to maggots, any open wound can get maggots infestation very badly. So first of all, we may not be able to see maggots in every wound. So we have to ask few questions like, do you have a crawling sensation? Do you feel anything is moving inside your wound? If suppose patient is telling anything like that, please make sure that either maggots are not there or the cause of that particular sensation. It may be some other reasons too, but usually it can be maggots, which is not always visible from outside. So prevention is mosquito nets, maintain personal and environmental hygiene, and management is apply turpentine and physical removal. Next slide. So the wounds which are infested with maggots, it should be always covered with dressing all the time and changed daily. And depending upon the number of maggots we doubt, we do actually dressing thrice a day, twice a day or daily. Usually in the beginning we do thrice a day. So by third or fourth day, even if we have 500 maggots on day one, we tend to end up in like no maggots at all by day four or five. Maximum is day six. So the procedure is apply fresh plain turpentine oil with syringe. sometimes if this is irritating, either the smell or this is irritating, we actually mix and then we use. We dilute and use. Wait for 10 minutes. You can even cover a gauze pad in turpentine and put it over the wound for some time. And we the thing is that we have to wait for 10 minutes so that the maggot slowly will come out of the wound. And always keep ready a kidney tray or a bowl with hot water. It's like very hot water or water with turpentine over it so that we can pick it up and put it in the bowl so that the maggots will die. Otherwise, what happens? It will crawl. If you keep a dry kidney tray or another bowl, or you keep on queue or started putting it on your Macintosh or somewhere, it will start crawling and it will move away the entire you know, the field that you are working on. So always keep ready another bowl with hot water so that you can pick it up and put it inside. Remove maggots with the help of forceps. Repeat procedure daily for 3 to 5 days. If malodor is present, metrogel powder mixed with lignocaine jelly, because this is the most cheapest thing that we can use in palliative care. Hardly less than 1 rupee is the price for a tablet metrogel. Bleeding, and even some there are many hospitals which is providing metrogel for free. Free samples, PHCs, and all, we can get it in bulk also. So always make sure that uncoated metrogel tablets are crushed. Bleeding, soak the dressing, apply pressure, sucralfate powder and adrenaline pads. This is another patient we had. So you can see the wound. Again, maggots infiltrate, maggots. There were lots of maggots in that. He was a drunk yet. So after all dressing, he really wished to have some drinks, rum and things like that. So what we did is, we have bought a kind of can that it is, and we emptied the content and we put some spirit swabs in. He just sits and smells it always. It is, we have not provided anything, but that smell itself was kind of very much comforting him. So always he smells that and sleep. Whenever it is very difficult to take that can from him because it always given him a lot of comfort. Then he was not, this patient also was not on morphine or anything. We were thinking that he may require everything, but with normal tramadol, his pain was completely managed. Now coming to pressure source. So any doubt in fungating wound, just ask towards the end of the session. Another common problem, another common wound in palliative care is pressure sores. Often develop on skin that covers bony areas of the body such as heels, ankles, hip, tailbone, etc. And being nurses, we really need to check under the breast, between folds and abdomen, between creases of buttocks, between thighs and all. So the causes are when body rubs together or moisture gets collected. And obese patients, skin-to-skin fold area where skin peeling can occur. But again, we need to check some areas, not only bony prominence, but under the breast, folds of abdomen, creases of buttocks and thighs, because moisture gets locked there and then it ends up in skin peeling. And we really have a tendency to put a lot of talcum powder also. This again will form into a really solid form with the... changes into a solid formation with the perspiration or sweat, and then again it gets accumulated and skin peeling. It ends up in skin peeling. Next slide. So prevention of pressure ulcer. So supporting surface, skin inspection, keep moving, incontinence and moisture control, nutrition. Supporting surface, make sure that the patient get pressure reliefs on proper supporting surfaces. Soft pillows, blankets, air beds, anything. Skin inspection, regular skin inspection requires all over the bony prominence and high risk areas. Caregivers must be able to pick the earliest signs of pressure injury. I will be discussing that later. Keep moving, do proper positioning, frequent posture changes, encourage patient's mobility. Incontinence and moisture control, bladder and bowel care, catheterized bladder if required, frequent changes of dressing and diapers to keep patient clean and dry. Echo. Nutrition. Nutrition and hydration. Patient must have right diet and fluid intake. Next slide. So these are the common pressure points for a bedridden patients. So being nurses, these are all areas you need to check for, like inspect it, all the areas thoroughly. Next slide. Next slide. So in wheelchair bound, again, all these bony prominence we need to check. So now coming to stages of bedso. Stage 1, we have 4 stages, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 and stage 4. Next slide. So first is beginning state, where skin is not broken, only discoloration, non-blanching. The site may be tender, painful, warm or cool compared to the surrounding skin. So the easy method is we need to check the surrounding skin, whether the color or warmth with the surrounding skin. So you can use the other side of your hand and then really touch and see, because sometimes the affected area may be warm compared to the surrounding areas. Sometimes it may be cooler than the surrounding areas. It depends upon the room temperature, or it depends upon the patient's body temperature. So it does not mean that always it should be more warm. It may be sometimes more cooler than the surrounding tissue. And same, it may not be always red in color. Sometimes it may be darker than the other skin, the regular skin tone of the patient. So always compare with the other areas where you have, where in which area where you are suspecting a stage sore pressure, a stage 1 pressure sore. Now coming to stage 2, where actually a blister formed or a ruptured blister you can see. The outer layer of skin, epidermis, and the part of underlying layer of skin, dermis, is damaged or lost. Shallow, pinkish shallow, and pinkish or red in color. So you can see the wound. Stage 2. It takes only 4 to 6 hours to really change the stage from 1 to 2 and 2 to 3. So if the patient is unattended for 24 hours, the very next day you can sometimes even see stage 2 going into stage 3. So it really requires a lot of nursing care to prevent this bed sore and manage bed sore in the early stages. Next slide. Now coming to stage 3. The ulcer is a deep wound now. Skin tissues are destroyed and fatty tissue may be involved. Infection may be involved. The bottom of the wound may have some yellowish dead tissue. Let's see the picture also. So it's like very deep wound, little more deeper wound. Now coming to stage 4, this is stage 4. Ulcer shows large scale loss of tissue. The wound may expose to muscle, bones or tendons. The bottom of the wound likely to contain dead tissue that is yellowish, dark and crusty. So sometimes you can see bones, sometimes you can see like real muscles in them. Next. Now coming to management. So stage 1, the main management is we will not be massaging the affected area. We will be massaging the nearby all the areas. I mean, affected areas, if we massage, there is a chance for skin peeling. So prevention in that, we rub the area, so in a circulatory motion. I will demonstrate when I come like directly after the session. Nothing like, you know, linear motion, it should be always circular motion. And stage 2 and 3, again the regular wound management, and sometimes we consider chemotherapeutic drugs and radiation therapy for if it is, you know, associated with a malignant wound and bed sore together, debridement surgery, infection, antibiotics if required, pain, deep pain, systemic analgesic, superficial pain, local application of lignocaine jelly or 0.25% bupivacaine, incidental pain, ketamine sublingually, like we are trying to change the position or do dressing or take the patient for physiotherapy, and then we give ketamine sublingually and do our procedure. Nursing care, positioning, changing position every 2 hours, special beds and mattresses like water bed, air cushion, backrest, foot rest, all comfort measures. And skin care, massage, circular movements, care of bony prominence, liquid paraffin, Vaseline application. Avoid applying powder, especially when it is humid and hot and humid areas like ours. We are not encouraging use of talcum powders at all for patients who are at risk for developing bed sores. Only moisturizers. Thank you.
Now it is a time for discussion about wound management, about how we manage or things. Is there anything to be clarified regarding malignant wound management?
Hello?
Yes.
Can you explain what is sucralfate powder?
Tablet sucralfate is available, but we crush it and use.
Okay, because I didn't know about tablet sucralfate. Thank you.
Any other questions?
What about those who are having wound on the inguinal region because of the contracted hip?
I didn't get the question.
Wound at the inguinal region because of the contracted hip, you know, because of the legs cannot be moved. Those who are paralyzed patients at the inguinal region, they get a kind of blood source because of the skin come across together, no? And because of that, they develop a kind of ulcer and wound there in the region.
Okay. So, what is the primary cause of development of a contraction? Whether it is an accident or sometimes this is very common with the mentally retarded children. So, if possible, contraction, like mentally retarded children and adults usually ends up in contractures, which is more of a rehabilitative part than, you know, just dressing. So, we really need to know how can these contractures released, whether surgically or like whether blocks, can, like the staging of contracture is needed. And sometimes muscle relaxants are provided. Sometimes, you know, you really have to undergo surgeries or some other kind of physical therapies, and simultaneously we have to do wound management, but then again the area of visualization may be very less. So the primary thing is not the wound management but the management of the contractions, all the supportive devices should be used in contractures. This is very common in mentally retarded adults and children, but then this is how we manage it here with the support of orthopedic department. It may not be, it can be in the inguinal areas, it can be in the hands, it can be in the shoulder, wherever, in all the joints. But we really need a physical medicine and a rehabilitation PMR department, the support, and either orthopedics department.
Another thing which can be done for an inguinal or any previous wound, like between inside the axilla or folds where the hands are really contracted, where you can't do anything in your own care. So what we do here is we can keep pillows between the legs, keeping the pressure of the inguinal region. So keeping, it's not like, or you can fold a towel in a thick manner. Keep it between the thighs so that the legs will be a little bit apart. Huh. And it is very important to clean the area and apply moisturizer so that your sweating, whenever the patient is sweating, that is not going to affect more and more. People use powder, and this is very abrasive. When the sweat is there, So when you apply talcum powder, it gets mixed and it itself will act as an abrasive. So avoid this powder and clean the area and apply any moisturizer.
Without this is more of preventive part of further occurrence.
Yeah.
But again, those really very badly affected with contractures,
yeah,
we really need to look into how contractures can be relieved.
Yeah.
Like as madam said, we can use pillows for further preventing. Like pads, again we roll it off and keep it. These contractures are possible even in the fingers of hands also. Sometimes, you know, thumb, they'll keep it inside and fold this for months together. And especially mental, like psychiatric patients and all. So when we try to get the patient from remote areas and all, where patients are locked, chained, this is very common thing. So first of all, we need to really understand the cause of all these contractures, how much ever releasing is possible. And pain management is very important. How much ever possible, wound has to be addressed. But it's again depends upon a lot of many other factors too. So a teamwork is really required.
So in order to prevent that wound, there can be used talcum or cannot be used?
I didn't get you, sister. In order to prevent?
I just want to make it clear whether can we. Here also the net is not clear, no, so I can't hear also problem. Can we use talcum or cannot be used in order to
talcum? No, talcum cannot be used.
If there is no wound or so, in order to prevent, what shall we use?
Moisturizer, paraffin, liquid paraffin, and things like that.
Okay, thank you.
If you apply a good moisturizing agent into the wound, if there is a small friction, will be there, that will not affect the patient's skin.
Okay, thank you.
It's like for chronic patients, better to avoid all types of talcum powders.
Any other query regarding fungating wound management of foul smells, experience, or pets?
There are lots of dressing materials available in the market, but then we really need to know what is the affordability part of it, availability of these materials. Lot of high exudate collecting materials are there, like different companies are now coming and giving, but then depends upon whether we can really use all these kind of things for our patient. Like for rich patients, we can use like Convatec dressing materials, again for deep flushes, for burns, a lot of materials are available. But then most of our patients that comes to palliative care ward, affordability is a major problem. So what we really use is common ghost, ghost pads, autoclaved, and then again using it.
Is there any other question? Or at least we move on to the presentation. So you can, if you apply metronidazole powder, you can mix with the white petroleum jelly. That would help to wound adherence, and it will help to wound healing also. That will give some moisture. If you apply metronidazole powder, you can just mix with the white petroleum jelly. I think for wound care, there are a lot of customized cares happening. I think what Anu was mentioning, salt evidence based, that's what is being practiced. But when you go to the village areas, like, you can see a lot of custom made things, but we can't propagate it as it is not People use a lot of aloe vera, turmeric,
honey, papaya, a lot of things that they use, but we are not. Because most of the time, whether honey or papaya, whatever be, we are welcoming ants to come and again bite the patient. And the other part is, all these kind of things will really bring maggots, flies and all, if it is not properly taken care of. And honey, you know, it is sweeter and things like that. Turmeric per se, sometimes it has got a burning sensation. So, I have even seen patients mixing turmeric with Metrogyl and then using, because turmeric is so culturally bond, like integrated with the wound management part in few villages. So even if we have given crushed Metrogyl powder in boxes and covers, they mix turmeric and then only they will use in coconut oil. But then it requires a lot of education. Okay, don't use this, use normal saline or homemade preparation of normal saline. Then slowly we can create awareness.
Shall we move on to the case presentation? Dr. Jim Simon is presenting to you, right?
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Yes, you are audible. Please start the presentation.
I'm Sister Dr. Jinsi Molami from Tamil Nadu. I'm presenting a patient, 54-year-old male from Thatchur, Thiruvannamalai, Tamil Nadu, who is a daily laborer by occupation, who is married and has no children, from low socioeconomic status. His presenting complaint was non-healing and infected wound on the left foot for 1 month, fever into 1 month, and decreased sleep into 1 month. Coming to the history of presenting complaint, patient, a known case of diabetes, presently not on medications, was apparently normal 1 month back when he developed a small wound on the left second toe following a trauma. He went to the local PHC and was taking on and off treatment. He developed pain and swelling of left foot. He was referred to GH and there they amputated his second toe, but the wound care was inadequate and it was associated with pain and purulent discharge. Patient was asked to discharge from the government hospital and he stayed home for a few days and then came to us in a very depressed and distressed condition with a lot of fear and anxiety whether his leg gets healed. Patient was in a depressed state because he thought that people were avoiding him because of his false smelling wound. Patient also had a fever associated with chills for 1 week. Coming to past history, patient was diagnosed diabetes 2 years back and he taken treatment for a few months and then discontinued. No history of hypertension, CVA, epilepsy or allergies. Family history, nothing significant. Personal history, his appetite was normal, bladder habits normal, he was complaining of constipation, takes a mixed diet, sleep reduced due to anxiety and fear. He uses tobacco and occasionally alcohol. He was emotionally depressed. Treatment history, Patient was put on oral hypoglycemic agents, insulin and antibiotics from CH, details of which were not available. His left toe amputation was done and some debridement was done in CH. An examination, patient in sitting position. On general physical examination, there was no pallor, icterus, clubbing, polyneuropathy or lymphadenopathy. Signs of cellulitis of left foot present. His BP was 130 by 80 millimeter of mercury, pulse 82 per minute, temperature 100 degree Fahrenheit. Local examination, on inspection, and single ulcer on the plantar surface of the foot, irregular in shape, about 8 into 5 into 1 centimeter in size. Margins were defined, edges are sloping, floor has a lot of slough and purulent discharge. Tendons were exposed. Redness and swelling of skin around and on the dorsal aspect of the foot too. On palpation, temperature was increased. Tenderness of the ulcer and on the surrounding skin. On pressure, pus was oozing. Movement of the ankle and toes were present. Peripheral pulses were palpated. Sensation pinprick and the vibration sensors were present. Left inguinal lymph node were palpable and tender. On systemic examination, RS, regular vesicular blood sounds, no heartbeat sounds. On CVS, S1, S2 were heard, no murmurs. Her abdomen was soft, no organomegaly or ascites. CNS hyamental functions were normal and cranial nerves were normal. Diagnosis, diabetic ulcer, left foot. Total count was 14,780. Differential count, neutrophils 86, lymphocytes 12, and eosinophils 2. Serum creatinine was 1.3, urea 48, ESR 52. Urine albumin plus, sugar were 3+, and ketones were negative. On X-ray foot, there was no signs of osteomyelitis or foreign body. Treatment given. Patient was admitted and a lot of counseling and hope was given. Debridement done under local after a thorough wash with eusol and metronidazole. Injection taxane, 1 gram IVBD. Injection diclofenac on and off whenever he was complaining of pain. Injection ranitidine IVBD. Tablet paracetamol 650 mg TID. Tablet metrogyl 400 mg TID. Tablet alprazolam 0.5 mg at night, tabdolcolax 2 hs, tabsedatopeptidase BD, and multivitamin OD. Sugar control was done using insulin, and IV fluids, NS was given, normal saline was given on the first 2 days. Daily BD cleaning and dressing using metrogyl gel. Lip elevation and IG paint application was given. Patient was given a diabetic diet. Course in the hospital, patient was very depressed and was not able to accept the situation and he had lost hope. After the counseling and first debridement and cleaning, which was done in a very compassionate way, patient was happy. After a few days, we asked his friends and relatives to visit him. That made a great impact and he was very positive in his outlook. He and the family was given health education on diabetes and its complications and how to take care of his food. We also made arrangements for him to get an MCR chapel. Now he is recommending all with the diabetes and with any other wound from his village to our hospital. Thank you.
Is there any specific question that you want to ask? or any other members in the team. I hope there are good servants, if I remember rightly. So is there any concern that you would like to ask about?
Hello.
Hello, Dr. Jinsi.
Yes.
Would you like to ask anything specifically regarding the wound to anyone else? I think Dr. Jinsi's network is very low.
It took about 2 months for his healing, the wound. Now it is completely healed, I think. I was using actually metrogel gel. Then first they went for the debridement, complete debridement was done. And I used actually metronidazole, actually the IV fluid for the washing of the wound. Is it advised for using metronidazole IV fluid?
Yes, I think Anu has mentioned that in her presentation regarding injection metronidazole radiation. Yes, that is. Any other question that you want to ask someone regarding the wound, or anyone else would like to comment on her management of the wound? Anu, we would like to hear from you whether you want to tell something about the case you presented.
One second. So for diabetic wounds, we have used insulin dressing. I really don't know, like our diabetologist will really gives like how much of insulin can be used, how to be used and all. So this really like make sure this really helps in faster healing, because you told that it is just a one toe amputation and it took 2 months for a proper healing and all. I think this would have better healed with use of insulin in while doing dressing section. And you need to clearly have a proper check on his diabetic profile, or like what is the diabetic status. Along with that, like that also helps him, because it is like 2 months is too long for a metro amputation to heal. And proper nutrition, hydration and every other thing, all the other drugs you have already asked, but then diabetic insulin dressing, whether it is okay or not, depends upon the clinical decision of a diabetologist or a surgeon. Here we are using it.
Any surgeon in the group who would like to comment on use of insulin? Because we have seen in many patients insulin is being used in many areas. So if someone would like to comment on that, or someone has experience in using insulin for the pet food. Sam, do you think is it an evidence-based practice, or is it just developed in your hospital?
Pardon?
Is it an evidence-based practice, or is it?
It is evidence-based. It is evidence-based. Because I have been using this insulin dressing for the past 14 years, maybe from my first year of college life, I'm seeing this. Depends upon the what is the diabetic profile of the patient, and we use normal insulin. It's evidence-based. And there are studies also. Diabetic patients' topical insulin cream markedly improve wound healing, representing attractive and costly method of treating this devastating complications. There are papers, enough and more papers actually.
Yes, some people do use it for bed sores, not only for diabetic patients, but even
I'm not sure regarding the other wounds whether insulin will help, but I have seen people using oxygen therapy for wound healing and things like that, but it's not so convenient to use it always, like using oxygen always. Then otherwise things are fine, especially for diabetic patients, this insulin really helps. And I have seen faster healing also, because 2 months for just a toe amputation, I think it is little more than the expected healing.
It is.
I wanted to ask Dr. Jyoti about the pain while dressing. Was there any pain while dressing? When removing dressing, cleaning each other? Complaints of pain.
Pain.
Yeah, pain.
Yes, yes. He used to get pain. So that time he used to give actually diclofenac injections.
Mostly. So was he happy with that? His pain is controlled?
The pain, actually, paracetamol he used to get controlled. Only during the dressing time, not every day, few days he used to complain. That time diclofenac injections used to give. And it was not just a toe amputation. Actually, all of his plantar aspect was.
I saw that. Because
the toe was amputated, then
it's fine. But then you can even consider. Good nursing care is again very important. But then again, next time, I'm not sure because I'm not a doctor to comment on these things. But again, you can have a consultation with anybody who are really using insulin dressing so that. If it is useful, you can use it in further in your future patients.
Yes. And that's the new this one. I have not heard of it.
Another suggestion from our side, like before doing, you can like as she mentioned in her presentation, you can use topical lignocaine or bupivacaine, the same as of that injection. Then you can use it topically. Calculating the dose per milligram per kilogram body weight, you can use it as diluted. If the wound is big, you need to dilute it. So if it is lignocaine, you just apply it before 15 minutes before your dressing. Just soak the dressing or directly apply the lignocaine over the wound. Bupivacaine take a longer time to act, so you have to apply it before 30 to 40 minutes. But the effect will last, so the patient will not need not take a systemic analgesia, and this will give a good baby. Your dressing will be perfect.
Usually, whenever debridement was doing, then I was giving the lignocaine.
So even for dressing, dressing also, if it is painful, we use this. And depending on the wound size, you can choose whether to dilute or not. And depending on your time, you can choose whether you want lignocaine or bupivacaine. But it is very useful, even for dressing changes.
Okay. Thank you.
I have shared an article to Shiva, madam, so that if he finds,
okay.
you can share to the others.
Okay. That in case of malodem, so you can use injection metronidazole nebulization also. So instead of that aspirin and or any that you can just
in that nebulizer, the collecting where we put aspirin, you know, there we can keep metrogyl and normal saline again. We can even put metrogyl normal saline together or metrogyl alone and put it in a wound where it is like deep creases, like a deep wound, so that sometimes, you know, maggots comes from tracheostomy areas and head cheek areas and all. That time we can even use metrogyl nebulization for reducing the malodor part of it. Any doubt? Any more clarification? Can you switch on my camera part of it so that I can demonstrate how to. So what I really want to demonstrate is just simple. Hello. So when you assess the skin warmth, always assess in this way with the surrounding skin and always massage in circular motion. So you can always teach your nurses to have massage in the bony prominence in a circular motion. Not like this or like this.
Summarizing Sister Anu's presentation today, so we heard about management of pressure sores and management of malignant wounds. So, without restricting her presentation entirely on managing the wound, she explained very well how it affects the person as a whole. And in the context that in our country we see a lot of head and neck cancer, it's still stigmatizing and how it affects a person psychologically, spiritually and sexually. So every aspect she mentioned, and that's how she emphasized the importance of wound care. And we heard about management of malignant wound, maggots, what all materials can be used to clean it, how to examine a wound, how to give good pain relief. That is a very important thing she mentioned. Ensuring analgesia before doing any dressing, whether it is a malignant wound or a bed sore dressing. Then she explains how to remove maggots, how to when the malodor, what all things to be taken care of, like controlling the infection. And another thing which you might have noticed is that two patients she mentioned, they both of them were not on any strong opioids. With good wound management and control of infections, they could easily control their pain. So that emphasized the importance of a good infection control and a good wound management. And very importantly, this has to be taught, shown and taught to the caregiver, then only there will be continuity of care. Not like nurses are just doing and sending the patients back home. The importance of analgesia, including infection, and seeing the patient's whole aspect when there is a wound. And next was on management of pressure sores, where we saw various stages of pressure sore. Unless you see the bottom of the pressure sore, unless you understand the depth, you can even call it as unstageable wound. When there is an eschar over the wound, you can't stage. You can't see where the bottom is, whether it is stage 4 or stage 3. And she very clearly shown which are the pressure areas, and we saw how to massage the pressure areas to prevent pressure, and how to give a good skin care, keep changing the position, use of mattress, avoid frictions by using talcum powders or moving the patient, dragging over the sheets. So any kind of sheer pressure can cause breakage in skin, and what to use and what not to use while doing a bed sore dressing. Making the bed sore dressing more economic and cheap, because there are a lot of dressings available in the market. And there are a lot of dressings which is being practiced in many parts. So basic principle is avoiding sheer pressure and avoiding any like friction with external material like talcum or even the dry skin. It itself will act as a friction material. So we saw how to manage that. And we saw the case presentation. And in that also Dr. Jinsi has mentioned not only the wound but also how the patient felt and how they managed him and how they managed him till he went home. And he became a advertisement for their hospital for wound care. So that's a very good thing that you get from giving a wound care. So that is what we learned from today's session on wound management. Is there anything else that you want to ask Sister Shiva? She's here regarding your sentence. And I would like to thank Anu for her time to spend with every one of us and share her knowledge about wound care. Thank you so much, Anu.
Thank you, ma'am.
I see that Dr. Sarita is here and she has discussed with us her patient story. And were you able to make any changes in the management with the recommendation, Dr. Sarita? And Dr. Sarita, 1 minute, we will unmute you. Please unmute yourself. Yes, now
sir, I couldn't follow your question.
So, you have discussed the patient story, isn't it? And we made something that can be done for managing that patient. Pain and some excoriation. So, what happened to that patient?
That patient, sir, actually now in that palliative care center, I have not gone. So 1 week, I do not have actually the idea about that patient. Last week, when I saw the patient, pain was increasing. Because in that palliative center, I go only once in a week. So last week, I missed going. So,
Will you be able to speak something about this patient next?
Pardon?
Will you be able to speak something about this patient next week?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Thank you.
So thank you all. We see the next session next week on Monday.
I hope all of you received your assignments first and second after the feedback, and the other two are pending, I think. So anybody who has not received the assignments, what to do? So Dr. Lucian, you have not received assignments 1 and 2?
I did not get assignment 3 also. I'm here now.
Okay.
Did you hear?
Sorry.
Can you send me your email ID in this chat session? Now you can see a chat session down in your window. If you can send your email ID in that chat, we'll check whether it is the right one you have.
Anybody else who has not received assignments 1 and 2? Shiva will inform you after some time. So, I think we will stop here. The next session will be on next Friday. So, thank you all. Thank you for joining. Okay, thank you. Let's stop here.